All ready, put your hands together, go absolutely wild for the most Googled man in Britain, Mr. Martin Lewis!
Hey!
Are we on? Delighted to see all that expense spared there. Hello everybody, how are we all? Woo! Dear me, it's my smile that wonky. Now, very interesting, he did just say the most Googled man in Britain. That is actually true, and on and off for the last sort of 7 or 8 years I've been either the most Googled person, or you hear that language, the most Googled man, because last year I was beaten by Kim Kardashian. Of course, with me, they're searching for my tips, and with Kim... Anyway, welcome! How are we all? Okay, let's get it out of the way to start with. Who got a free ticket?
Hey!
Who didn't get a free ticket? You all need to listen very carefully. It's delightful to see you all. And now, just to get some indication, who's been and seen me speak at Ideal Home before? Okay, Martin, change your material. Don't say what you did last year. Right. Now, I always like to start with a little bit of a warm-up for me, and this is my first one here, and a little bit of a warm-up for you. Now, last year, I did my good debt, bad debt quiz. This year, something different. We're going to play a game. It's a consumer rights game. I'm going to ask you one of three questions. You're going to put your hands up when you think you know the right answer, then I'm going to tell you the right answer, and you're going to go, oh, I didn't think it was that. Did you know that? I didn't know that. No, I'm telling boy. Right, so let's go on. Question number one. Are you all listening very carefully? You bought a polka dot shirt in a store. You take it home, and your wife tells you you have absolutely no taste. It has to go back. You're never wearing that when you're out with me. Thank you very much. You take it back to the store the next day. What are your legal rights? Legal rights. A. You have a right to a refund, provided you have the receipt. B, you have a right to a refund, provided you have any form of proof of purchase. Or C, you have no right to a refund whatsoever. So A, I said hands up. Behave or I get vicious. So who thinks it's A, you need a receipt to have a full refund, hands up loud, hands up in the air? Who thinks it's B, you only need proof of purchase? Who thinks it's C, you have no right to a refund? Let me tell you something that's really fascinating. I spoke 2 weeks ago at the Retail Week conference, which is a massive conference of UK retailers where I really pissed them off because I said to them at the end that I want you to know that I will be telling consumers that when you have bad delivery online, do not blame the delivery company, blame the retailer. And if you choose to use a bad delivery company, I hope you have brand damage. And they booed me. That's fine. That's what I went there for. You got to spread a message. But I also did this quiz with them, and a lot more of them got that wrong than you did. So you beat the people who actually work in the retail industry, because the correct... Well done. Well done. We have some money savers in the house.
Yeah.
Right. The correct answer is C. You have no right to a refund. Now, this is a really important thing to understand whenever you're shopping, including here. You can only take goods back if they are faulty. Can anyone know my mnemonic, my memory cue for faulty goods? Does anyone here know? Come on, someone be brave. You do. Sad fart. Sad, you were nodding over there. Sad fart. Go with me. Remember, everybody say sad fart.
Sad fart.
One more time louder, just for the hell of it.
Sad fart.
Marvellous. A whole group, 600 sad farts standing out there. Goods must be of satisfactory quality, as described, that's sad, fit for purpose, and, I cheated with the A, and last a reasonable length of time. If they're not of satisfactory quality, fit for purpose, and last a reasonable length of time, then they are defined as faulty. Then as long as you take them back without having accepted them, which has no real time limit at the moment, but will soon be 30 days, you can have a full right of refund. Simple as that. But if they're not faulty, if you buy the wrong size, if you change your mind, you cannot take goods back. I can't tell you how often I've been in stores. It's always a nightmare for me. It's a nightmare doing my job sometimes. just a few weeks ago, I was in, I won't tell you the name of the store, but I was with Uncle John, anyway, and I was in Uncle John's store, think about it, you'll get there in a moment, and a man came up to me, and he'd been at the queue, and I'd heard him having an argument, I wasn't listening, he said, he'd been about whether he could send goods back, and he said,
look who I've just seen, you're in trouble now. My mate. Will you tell them they won't let me take these goods back? You know, say I don't have a receipt. And I said, is it faulty? He said, no, I just want to change it. I said, they're right. So what type of consumer champion are you? Well, I'm the one who gives you the right answer, and it's something that you have to understand when you buy or you purchase anything. So really important to remember that. Now, there was one really interesting one here, which is I always say, and actually a judge was listening to me speak the other day, and he pointed this out to me, and he's right. I always say that you can't take goods back if they're the wrong size. The only slight amendment to that is, let's say you bought a size 14 dress, gentlemen. You bought a size 14 dress and you are a size 14, and you take the dress home and actually they've labelled it size 14, but under any legitimate purposes this is a size 8, and it's got the wrong label on it or the sizing is wrong, then it's not as described because size 14 is a legitimate statement and you have some expectation of what that is. But I'm talking in general terms this would work. The only exception to this is if the store has a published returns policy, think Marks and Spencers, that says you're allowed to take goods back within 30 days, then that is a contractually binding thing as opposed to a general legal thing, and therefore you can enforce it. Let's do question number two. Are you ready? I bought a £24,000 kitchen. I paid £200 of it on my credit card. This was a really lovely, beautiful kitchen. I paid the rest with a bank transfer, and the kitchen company's just gone bust. I've gone to the credit card company. What am I legally entitled to from the credit card company? Remember, paid £200 on the credit card, the remainder of the £24,000, I paid bank transfer. Am I entitled from the credit card company? A, nothing. B, £200. C, £24,000. What am I entitled to? Okay, let's do A. Who thinks I'm not entitled to anything from the credit card company? Hands up. Who thinks it's B, £200? Who thinks it's C, £24,000? We do have money savers in the house.
Yeah.
You're so much better than the retailers. Boosh! The correct answer, and this is a true story, C, £24,000. Under Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act, if you buy goods that cost, listen to my language, I'm being very accurate, goods that cost between £100 and £30,000, and you pay for any of it, even 1p, on a credit card, the credit card company is liable for the entire amount. Shocking, isn't it? Slightly unfair on the credit card companies, if we're really honest, isn't it? Oh dear. So let's just think about this for a second. This is a very valuable extra consumer protection. Now again, go with my language. Jointly liable. What this means is, if you buy goods from a store and you pay for any on a credit card and it's over £100, if something goes wrong, not just if the store goes bust, if something goes wrong, if it's faulty, you can choose to take it back to the credit card company. You do not have to go to the store first. Now, normally they'll say, can you take it to the store, please? You are perfectly allowed within your consumer rights to say, no, I'm taking it to you, you're the credit card company, you're jointly liable, and I want you to sort it out. Now, this may be convenient if you happen to buy it in a store in the United States, for example, so you can't take it back, or you live in London and this is a little shop in Cornwall, then it's a lot easier to call up the credit card company. Of course, they're not going to give you a replacement or repair it, they're just going to have to give you a cash value instead. Now, this power is actually a really interesting one because it gives you an extra protection as well that people don't talk about. Now, you've been very good so far, so let's do a test. If you go to a retailer because you've got a problem with a retailer and it lets you down, what do you have to do? What is your only recourse to force them to action? Anyone? Come on, someone must know. Be brave, someone in here. Well, no repair. No, where would you take them? Small claims court. You would take them to court, wouldn't you? If a credit card company lets you down, where can you take it? The Ombudsman. You can take it to court, but you can also take it to the Ombudsman. Now listen to this. It's all going right. Everyone follow me so far. When you go to the financial ombudsman, when you go to a court, it judges on the law. What does the law say? Have you breached the law? Nothing else. The financial ombudsman judges on three factors. Oh, there's a very big man copying me. It judges on three factors. A, the law, so the same as the court. B, standard industry practice, so how do others behave? C, and this is the killer, have you been treated fairly? Isn't that nice? Isn't that nebula? What does fairly mean? So actually, even if they haven't broken the law, but they haven't treated you fairly in common parlance, the ombudsman can rule. I said this was a true story. It was a woman who'd used the information on my site when her kitchen went bust. She went, it was Tesco credit card. Tesco credit card said, absolutely not, we'll give you your 200 quid back. She took them to the financial ombudsman. It awarded her the full £24,000 and about £1,000 on top because Tesco's had messed her around. That's how powerful this is. So if you're going to make any big purchases anywhere, if you happen to be doing it, don't let the retailers hear. Everyone laugh. Good, well done. But if you're making any big purchases, just in case something goes wrong, a little bit of it on your credit card, if it's over 100 quid, is a massive extra protection and very much worth doing. You're doing very well. Question number three. We'll see how good you are. You bought yourself a little statuette of Lawrence Llewellyn Bowen online. You were very excited about it. It arrived home and you suddenly realised you got Lawrence confused with George Clark and he was the one you really wanted because he wants a goatee anyway. So you decide you're going to send it back. Online purchase, you've changed your mind. What are you legally entitled to? A, you cannot send it back, it isn't faulty. B, you're allowed to send it back within 7 working days. C, you're allowed to send it back within 14 days. Who thinks it's A, you can't send it back? Just you. I won't tell anyone. And you're not right. Oh, and you. When I was doing the you're not right thing, you should have put your hand down. That's what we would have all done. Who thinks it's B, 7 working days? Now, come, you've got to say one of the next two, and some of you are hedging. I want hands up if you think it's 7 working days. Who thinks it's 14 days? I am very impressed with you. It is, again, 14 days. Now, this changed last year. It used to be 7 working days under the distance selling regulations. Anyone know what the new regulation's called? Consumer contract regulations. You now have 14 days. Just note, by the way, this is quite important. It used to be 7 working days. It's now 14 days. It's not quite as long as you think. Quick spot check. If you paid £25 for your Lawrence statuette and it cost £5 delivery, do you get £25 back or do you get £30 back? £25? £30? You do get your £30 back. If it costs you another £5 to send it back, do you get £30 or £35? Who thinks £30? Who thinks £35? It's £30. You get the cost of the goods plus the cost of them delivering it to you back, but you are not by law entitled to the cost of sending it back to them. You have to foot that bill. Many companies do actually give you that cost back as well, but not all, they don't have to do it by law. So that was our consumer rights quiz, and I am very, very impressed. What we're going to move on to now, let's see how the time's going. Not bad, we've got some. I'm going to do a series of different topics, and I brought with me a very high-tech piece of equipment so you can try and help me understand what you really want to talk about. It works a bit like this. I'm going to say two subjects. If you like the first subject, after I've said it, you say bzzz. If you like the second subject, you say bing. So there's a bzzz and a bing. So we'll just take a little spot one here. We'll just have a practice here. Lawrence Llewellyn Bowen versus George Clark. Lawrence is a bzzz. George is a bing. Lawrence? George? George won that one. Right. So here we go, it's been budget week this week. Two major announcements that affect personal finances. The Help to Buy ISA or the new Personal Savings Allowance. That's the £1,000 allowance on savings. Who would like to hear Help to Buy is Buzz and Personal Savings Allowance is Bing, and make your noise on the count of three. One, two, three. Can we now do Buzz and Bing between who thought the first one won and who thought the second one won? Do it again. One, two, three. I think that's new Personal Savings Allowance, don't you? Yeah, okay. So, this is what's been announced in the budget. From April 2016, you will be allowed to earn £1,000 of interest on your savings if you are a basic rate taxpayer without paying any tax on that. Now let's just think about what that means in practice for a second at current rates. The top paying easy access savings account at the moment is actually a bank account. It's the Santander 123 bank account. Yes, you can get higher rates, but it's the only one that gives a decent rate on a decent amount of money. If you had money in Santander 123 at 3%, you could put £33,000 away. That would earn you £1,000 interest and it would be tax-free. So at the top rate, you could save £33,000 tax-free. Now someone, just before you get technical, I'm aware the most you can put in Santander 123 is £20,000, but it's worth noting if you're married, you can have a joint account as well. So you can technically have two accounts, so you could put £40,000 in it. So Yabu sucks to whoever was thinking that one. Now, let's move on. So that's the basic concept. If you're a higher rate 40% taxpayer, you can only have £500 of savings tax-free. Although, interestingly, let's just do some maths. You're a 20% taxpayer, you can have £1,000 of savings tax-free. How much is it saving you, this new allowance? Wait, who said that there? £200. We've got a microphone on this lady, quickly. Okay, you can shout that, it's £200. If you're a 40% taxpayer, you're allowed £500 tax-free. How much is that saving you?
Get the mic over there, 1 second. Can I squeeze through? It's kind of Jeremy.
40% of £500?
Is.
Say the same answer as you get.
100.
200. You see the point? On both, you save. You're effectively saying you're given £200 worth of tax, regardless of your tax status. And for anyone here lucky enough to be an additional rate 45% taxpayer, you don't get anything. That's the way it works. So, this brings some really interesting consequences of thought of how this will change the savings landscape. Of course, we do have to look at the fact that this is in a budget that hasn't yet passed in the finance bill, and we will potentially, not necessarily, have a new government in a couple of months' time. Although Ed Balls, and I saw him the other day on this, has said that Labour do support this scheme, so I think it's pretty likely whatever happens come April 2016, this will be a new way that we save, and it really is a very different thing. Many people have said to me, will this kill the ISA? They don't tend to say it like that, but it was quite good, wasn't it? Should we do it again? Will this kill the ISA? I'm thinking of doing a film strip based on that. Probably still a money saving, maybe. Okay, so what does this mean for your savings? If you're allowed to save tax-free up to £33,000, why would you bother putting your cash in an ISA? Makes sense, yeah? Because an ISA is just a savings account that you don't pay tax on. I like to hypnotise people for this because people always get confused and think an ISA is something really complicated. It isn't. A cash ISA is just a savings account that you don't pay tax on. A cash ISA is?
Savings account that you don't pay tax on.
Good, I got the message through, so let's move on. So you would say, if you're not going to pay tax on your savings anyway, why would you use an ISA? And I've read lots of people saying this in the papers. I actually think they're wrong. I would still, generally, use a cash ISA as my first point of call, even if I wasn't going to be able to save that much. And there are a number of reasons why. The first thing to understand is I've done that math based on the best easy access savings account right now. At some point, interest rates are going to go up again. I'm not saying this year, next year, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, but at some point they will be higher than they are now. If we go back to the old normal, 2007, the top paying savings account paid around 7%. A at 7%, your £1,000 of interest tax-free is actually around 14 grand of savings. That's less than just 1 year's ISA allowance. So suddenly you can see it doesn't necessarily protect that much money. Now, you're allowed to save £15,000 a year in a cash ISA. And once you put that money in, you save it year after year. So let's just imagine, it might actually go up to 15,240, but I'm going to keep the numbers simple for you all. If I was lucky enough to have the money, and I am, right? I could put £15,000 in this year, £15,000 in next year, 30, £15,000 in the year after, 45, £15,000 in the year after, 60, and you see the point. So you can actually shelter a lot of money from inside a cash ISA. So using this year's allowance is actually future-proofing you from future taxation. But it gets more interesting than that, because of course you might earn more and be a higher rate taxpayer, so suddenly what you thought you could protect from tax, you can't protect from tax anymore. And currently, top paying easy access standard cash ISA, 1.5% with the post office, top paying easy access standard savings account, 1.4% with Coventry Building Society. So you're earning more in an ISA, straight rate for rate, even without tax gain, even if you're not paying tax. And more so, and this is the one that people really don't get because it's quite technical, but it's worth listening to. If you put your money in a fixed rate savings account, let's say a 2 year fixed rate savings account, your money is locked in for 2 years. You cannot access it. Cash ISA providers are not allowed to lock you in. So if you put your money in a 2 year fixed rate cash ISA, they must allow you to access it. What they normally do is they levy penalties, interest penalties, if you withdraw. But let me give you an example of my favourite ISA right now. There was actually a better one 3 days ago, but I put it in my email and it went within 6 hours, so I ignore that. How much? Someone shout loud, come on, the brave ones of you are savvy and maths on here. Help me, because I like a conversation. How much of a year is 120 days? A third. Brilliant. A third of a year. So, it's paying you 2.25%, you're meant to keep it in for 3.5 years. If you take it out after a year, you lose a third of your interest. What's a third off 2.25?
0.8.
Let's call it 1.5%. What's the best paying easy access cash ISA paying at the moment? 1.5%. So as long as you, it's actually 1.51 is a third off the rate. So it's, as long as you keep the money in for a year, you're getting a better deal than the top easy access payer right now anyway. Keep it in for 2 years, you're earning about 1.8%. Keep it in for the full time, you earn 2.25%. So you see the flexibility that gives you. You get a guaranteed rate, unlike a variable rate, and you can access the money if you needed it. So why would you put your money in a fixed rate savings account if the rates are roughly similar, and they may move to when this all happens, we may see some rate changes. I put it in a cash ISA because I get the flexibility of being able to access my cash. So rumours of the death of cash ISAs, I think, are greatly exaggerated even under the personal savings scheme. The people that will help, I'll be honest, it's everybody else out there who isn't listening right now. Because having heard the way you answered those initial questions, you will all put it in an ISA. Those people won't be putting their money in ISAs anyway because they're not listening to me and it serves them right. And they, however, will be safe paying the tax that they would have paid otherwise on a bank account. It also means those of you who do have a Santander 123 or something like that that pays a much higher rate will get the tax gain too. So that is a bonus and a boon there. Okay, next subject. How about just one more and then we'll go into questions. Should I buy my euros now for the summer versus how do I slash the cost of my mobile phone? So should I buy my euros now for a summer is bzzz, slash the cost of my mobile phone is bing. Okay, are you ready to vote on the count of three? 1, 2, 3. Bing. I think, no lobbying. I think the bing is more sibilant, so I think it's potentially louder than the buzz. So if it was roughly, let's do it one more time. 1, 2, 3. I think that's a buzz. Do you think that? Yes, I think that's a buzz. Okay, should I buy my euros now for the summer? My answer is, I don't know. I have no clue. clue. I'm not a currency speculator, and even if I were, I wouldn't know. So the most important thing to understand conceptually, no one knows what is going to happen. The current rate is £1 buys €1.38. It's important to understand this isn't an issue of the pound being strong. This is an issue of the euro being weak. A year ago, a pound bought you $1.68. It now buys you $1.47. So against the dollar, the pound has dropped. But against a year ago, it was £1 bought you €1.20. Now it's €1.38. 2 years ago, it was £1 bought you €1.15. So certainly, if you were to head into Europe right now, things would look much, much cheaper than they have done for the last 7 or 8 years. And that also means, by the way, that it's not that if you were to book your hotel now and book your car hire, you would hope that price had filtered in somewhat, so that would be relatively cheaper as long as you're in the Eurozone, Spain, France, Germany, North Turkey. It also means that it's really worth looking at if you're going on holiday booking a cheap villa, because if you book a cheap villa abroad from one of the sites and there are protections that you need to follow, you pay directly in Euros and therefore you get an automatic benefit from the high euro rate. But what you asked me, or more accurately, I asked myself and then you buzzed, but let's move on and not worry about that. What you asked me is, should I buy my euros right now? Now, the honest answer is, a week and a half ago, it was at 141. Now it's at 138, and it went up and it goes down all the time. And anybody who tells you they know what will happen to the currency rate is lying. So we have to twist this and we have to say, let's not predict the market. Here's what you really need to think of if you're going on holiday this summer. Do I like the current rate? What would give me more happiness? If I locked in now at £1 buys €1.38, and that would give me a good price on holiday, and I am happy to get the security of knowing I will get a good price on holiday. And if I did lock in, but the rate got even better and I'd missed out, I wouldn't care because I know I got a good enough rate anyway. You should lock in. If, however, you did that and you know that if the rate got better, you couldn't enjoy your holiday and you would be slapping yourself across the face because you should have waited at the time, you shouldn't lock in. And that is actually the only decision that you have to make on this. Personally, and this is not a recommendation, this is simply what I do, I get the best rate I can when I go. Because I would certainly be annoyed with myself. Now, how do you get the best rate? Let's do a show of hands. Who in here has either a Halifax Clarity credit card, a Post Office credit card, a Saga credit card, or a Nationwide Select credit card? Hands up in the air. Yeah, thought so. I know what type of audience I've got. The best way to spend abroad, full stop, no question, no discussion, and when we're not talking about locking in rate, Halifax Clarity credit card. Halifax Clarity credit card. This is how it works. Has anyone noticed, by the way, if you've been abroad in the last year and you use a credit card that isn't one of those I mentioned, or a normal debit card, it now has this new charge called the sterling transaction charge. You nodding. Did it annoy you? Can I tell you something that's going to annoy you even more? This isn't a new charge. It's just that in the last year, for the first time, they've had to tell you about it. You've been being charged this for years. But in January 2014, new regulations came in that said they used to just hide it in the exchange rate, but they had to break this out separately. This is what's called technically a load. When you spend abroad on your debit or credit card, the debit or credit card company gets the Visa or MasterCard wholesale rate, a near perfect, best possible, near the spot exchange rate you can get. And then they add 3% on it when they give it to you. So if you buy something that costs £100 worth of euros, you would pay £103 for it. Halifax Clarity credit card, you pay £100. There's no load. Why do I put it better than the other cards I mentioned? Because it has lower cash withdrawal fees. Simple. Go on, Sam.
I'm filming.
Okay. It has lower cash withdrawal fees. So you get one of these cards, you pay it off. Are you ready? You pay it off in full.
In full.
Gotta do better than that. You pay it off.
In full.
Thank you very much. At the end of every month, so there's no interest, but there will be interest if you withdraw cash on it, because there always is on credit cards. It'll normally be about £1 per £100. That's still beating Bureau de Change. But when you're using it, use it for spending. Don't withdraw your money and spend that unless you have to. Spend on the card when you're abroad. Cheapest way to spend, as long as you pay it off in full. If you don't get that card, and by the way, we now have the eligibility checker on moneysavingexpert.com, which tells you without leaving a mark on your credit file which of these cards you're most likely to get, so you can home in your application without damaging your credit file to do it, to see if it's liable. If you can't get one of those cards and you prefer cash, then you just need to do a comparison. Ignore commission-free. Commission-free is a load of absolute baloney, because what they do is just give you a worst exchange rate. What you need to do is you need to ask them, I've got £500, I want to convert it. Well, you wanted a bit of quick talking during it. I've got £500, I want to convert it into euros. What rate are you going to give me? After everything, how many euros will you give me? That's the question. How many euros, after all your taxes, charges and translation rate? Ignore anything else, that's how you compare it. You can use Travel Money Max to give you the best rate on that. Or you can lock yourself into a prepayment card. Now, prepayment cards, a bit like electronics, travellers' checks, you load money up, you can spend them abroad like a Visa or a MasterCard. Now, the thing to remember about these cards, unlike the credit cards, which give you the rate on the day, these give you the rate on the day you load them. So it is, if you wanted to lock in the current euro rate, it is a good way to lock in the current euro rate, but if the rate moves against you, just like buying cash. Now, the top paying euro prepaid cards at the moment, I like the UCash card, UKASH, best rates and lowest fees in general, unless you're loading on over £500, in which case the FairFX card gives you £8 on top of the £500 that beats it, but the FairFX card costs £10 unless you go via the comparison site Money Supermarket, in which case you get the card for free and it will beat it during that. Question answered on that? Right, what have we got? Oh, I haven't got that long left. I had loads more. Things that I could have asked you about, told you about, with energy, bank savings account, water bills, student finance, cutting debt costs, tips to, I can't read my own writing, flight delays, and finally, how do you win at Monopoly? No one's ever asked me that question yet. But you know, we do have a question and answer session coming soon. So, I'll move it on. The floor is now yours. Put your hand up soon. We're going to get busy and rushed out, and I have to warn you, I will do pictures afterwards, and I'm delighted, but I can't do questions afterwards because I would be here until 2018. So, if you've got a question, please ask me now. We're going to take two at a time. Take this lady here, then this lady there.
Hello. Thanks, Ross.
I'm going to get my pension in 2 months' time.
Don't believe it.
When do I buy my Lamborghini?
Okay. And the lady at the back. I'll answer that while we're doing it. So, pension. We have radical changes happening to pensions in this April. We're going to have the so-called pension freedom. I have some great concerns about pension freedom, and not the Lamborghini issue, because you're not going to buy your Lamborghini either. Let me tell you what really worries me. Brief summary of what's happening in the pension changes for those who don't know. If you have a private pension where you have a pot of money, you built up your pot of money. In the old days, you got 25% of it as a tax-free lump sum, and then effectively, not, we won't get technical, you had to use the rest to buy an annuity. An annuity is a product that pays you each year for the rest of your life until you die. But if you die early, in general, and there are always sidelines on this, your family don't get the money. Now, you have your pension pot, you take 25% of it tax-free lump sum, and if you choose to, you can take the rest out when you like, and you pay tax on it like income tax. So if you're within the 20% band, you can take the money out and you pay 20% tax on it. My biggest concern, and the one that scares the pants off me, and the background to this is, most people, when you buy an annuity, there are lots of different rates, and you look into those rates for the rest of your life, and 60% of the population just got their annuity from the pension company and effectively forgoed extra income for the rest of their life by not even bothering to compare the market because they didn't understand it. So we know that there is mass financial ignorance of people who are taking out their pensions. We know that, that's fact, because no one would have done that if they knew that it was the wrong thing to do. 60% of the population. We also know that when we have low interest rates and low inflation, older people who have savings should be spending their capital. They shouldn't be, you know, but what they won't spend their capital, they will only spend their interest. They see it as income and they don't want to touch their capital. The nodding heads of people who understand this out there of my argument. So here's what worries me. You've got your, let's say, £100,000 pension pot. The only way to know how much you should spend is to know when you will die. Not a joke, I am actually in the middle at the moment of building a when you will die calculator. Genuinely, if you know someone's age, their height, their body mass index, whether they're a smoker or not, and their postcode, you can have within a pretty good percentage of when they'll die. I did my own on the W1, I'm going to go to 80. I've got 39 years left. You know, but actually, interestingly, if you get to 65, this is how mortality rates work, as an average man, you'll have 18 more years, as an average woman, you'll have 21 more years. So I don't know how old you are, but let's go with that and say that typically you'd expect to live to 86. So if we take your money, you'd roughly want to spend 5% of your money a year. Well, we're getting complicated, aren't we? The only way to know how much you should spend is to know when you will die. So I would add 10% on top because you might be lucky or unlucky enough to live longer. Right? You can decide which way you want to factor that in your own head. And here's my problem. If you give older people, or younger people for that matter, but they tend not to have the cash, a large amount of money and say it has to last you to the rest of your life, they don't touch it because they are petrified they will not have any left. So my worry about pension freedom, and I believe it was Peter Parker who said, with great freedom comes great responsibility.
Benjamin Parker.
Spider-Man's uncle.
Benjamin Parker.
Benjamin Parker. Peter Parker was the ex-chairman of British Rail, thank you. Uncle Ben, Uncle Ben's right.
Yes.
So, nice superhero quote, thank you, I enjoyed that. Now, moving on, and this is the point. I think we're going to have a lot of people who have their pension money and won't touch it and live worse lives than they should be doing so because they are petrified of spending it. And worse, while many people celebrated the fact that George Osborne recently said we are going to stop taxing the amount you leave in your pension, 55% of it used to go. Now all of it can go to relatives apart from inheritance tax. We've just incentivized people even further not to spend their cash because it can now go somewhere relatively tax efficiently. So my worry is a lot of people will not have good lives in retirement because they are too frightened. And perhaps what we really need is some type of plan that you could sort of cash in and give you income each year for the rest of your life. Oh, no, we just got rid of those. So I have a lot. It's great. The new pension freedom is wonderful for the financially savvy, as freedom and choice always is for the financially educated. It gives you lots of options. I'm personally delighted about it. I'm petrified about what it means for those people, and we have a mass financially ignorant population. I've spent my career trying to change that. I'm petrified of what it means for them. So what you should do is you should work out when you're going to die. You should go and get, if you've got a decent pension pot, you should pay for independent financial advice. There's products out there called flexible drawdown that you're going to be able to do, which enable you to take some income but leave some capital and move it on. You may be better leaving it in your pension. You may even want to get an annuity with some of it to provide yourself with a guaranteed income. It's a very difficult decision. And can you see why I'm concerned about freedom? Freedom's a good thing. But sometimes people can't cope with all the freedoms they're given when it's a complicated decision. I know in my life, lots of people contact me and they say, I didn't understand it, but you said to do it, so I did it. And that scares the pants off me, because you have to understand it. And that's the problem with freedom. The lady there, next question. I hope that came some way to answering your question.
Section 75 protection on credit cards, does that apply to prepaid credit cards?
There's no such thing as a prepaid credit card. They are prepaid cards. There's no credit.
But aren't you using it under the
No. Section 75 is a credit law, not a card law. That actually applies to any form of credit that is hypothecated to an individual form of spending. In other words, I have spent and bought something specific. It doesn't apply to a loan because that's just a general amount of cash you then choose to spend. It does apply to catalogue spend, for example, because that's for something specific. Prepaid cards are not credit products. And as they're not credit products, Section 75 does not apply to them. I think we had some questions over there. We'll do that lady there, then that gentleman there. I'll move through that way.
Right, let's go.
We'll do one at a time, hopefully.
Hi, my question is, what's the best way of saving for children who get gifts from relatives, particularly grandparents, but random odd amounts, so there's no certainty that you'll get
regular gift each month? rates tend to be very poor on children's accounts, just like any other accounts. The best paying children's account on the market is the Halifax Regular Saver, which allows you to put between, if you've already done it, but for everyone else, allows you to put between £10 and £100 in a month at 6%. After that, Halifax actually has some products that are paying 3% easy access, and that's about it. What about the junior ISA? What about the pension? Look, putting money in a pension for your child is a relatively good thing to do, because if you can put up to £3,600 a year for a pension for your child, they can take it when they're 55. It's got 55 years to grow in the market. It's a very, very generous thing to do. There's a moral point for you then. When your friends and relatives have given your children money, I have a suspicion they weren't envisaging a 55-year-old with grey hair that they were giving the cash to. I suspect they were imagining, oh, Papa, right? So I personally, and it's your decision, but this is, you're a custodian of your child's money, it's not your child's money. I would suspect if you or a grandparent deliberately wanted to give them money to put into a pension, that seems to me to be fair, but a custodian of your child's money, I think you might want to give your child the option to spend it when they get to a relevant age. Do you understand what I'm saying? But you certainly, it would be tax efficient for you to give the money in a pension, it's something I've done for my own daughter. But but you see my argument on that. But I'm not trying to tell you what to do. If you think that's the best use of the cash, putting money in a pension for your child is a really effective thing to do once you've used up all the other tax advantages that are out there. Does that include
the junior ISA?
Oh, I'm not a big fan of the junior ISA. The reason I'm not a big fan is the rates aren't that good. And do under 10s pay tax? Who thinks yes, who thinks no? Who thinks yes? And who incorrectly thinks no? Everybody pays tax. But everybody currently can earn £10,000 a year tax-free without paying tax on it, and most under 10s do not earn over £10,000 a year, so they don't pay tax. That's the point. And of course, in future, we'll all be able to earn £1,000 in our savings, so it won't really matter. So the benefit of money in a junior ISA is relatively limited. You're locking the money away until they're 18. Remember, really important, on their 18th birthday, it's theirs, not yours. If they want to spend it on following One Direction, who by then will have grey hairs and probably drug addicts, and certainly will have split up. If they want to spend that money on following One Direction, sorry if I offended if they want it, 1Ds, I'll probably get hate mail on the back of that, won't I? Don't tell anyone. Cut that bit from the video. So if they want to, that's their choice, even if you've saved it to buy a deposit on a house for them. So junior ISA doesn't give you much spending flexibility. It locks the cash away until they're 18, not a responsible 55. And doesn't actually, unless you already have so much money saved for them, give them tax advantages. Now the tax on children's savings is actually quite interesting. Some may say, if my kids can earn £10,000 without paying any tax on it, why don't I put all my savings in their name? Because they thought of that. You're allowed to put money into your children's name as a parent that generates them up to £100 worth of interest a year. After that, it's taxed at your rate. But all this money is from friends and relatives, so that can be saved in their name tax-free. I think I'm going to move on to another question. Interesting subject, though, it is.
I was going to ask what protection you've got buying on PayPal, because I've bought something on PayPal, free delivery, and then they knocked off £30. They said they loaded it onto a lorry, even though I cancelled the order because they messed it up.
Section 75 does not apply for PayPal, even if you use your credit card to purchase on PayPal, because it's an indirect transaction and it breaks the hypothecated spending link that I rather pointedly mentioned a few moments ago. PayPal has its own internal protection scheme, and you of course have any consumer rights protections that you would buy from anywhere else, but it's not close to Section 75. Not close in terms of protection. You're reliant on PayPal's own scheme, which isn't a legal thing, it's just the terms and conditions of a product.
But how can they charge you delivery when it said free delivery?
Well, they can't, and that's not an issue. You're confusing the mechanism of payment with the fact that satisfactory quality as described, fit for purpose and last a reasonable length of time. It was not as described, you therefore have retail rights. Your problem is, how do I enforce them? This is one of the great problems with consumer rights, I have to say. You're therefore going to court. When I gave evidence on the Consumer Rights Bill at Parliament, my biggest point was we need an alternative dispute resolution mechanism, a mechanism that says when I've got a £30 issue, I don't want to go to court and pay a £50 court fee to sort it out. We have something called the Retail Ombudsman. Nowhere near enough stores do it. I don't have that much faith in it yet. It's a problem. Unfortunately, it's not one I can give you a solution to, I'm afraid. That's not my fault.
Okay, thank you.
Martin, on that very quickly, is it the person that she bought the item from off of an auction site, I'm guessing, that she'd go back to, or would it be... Because PayPal's...
No, you're the retailer. It's always the retailer. PayPal gives you its secondary rights as a protection itself, but your rights are with the retailer. Now, it's worth noting, if it's an auction, and it's a genuine auction from someone who does not make any form of their living selling goods, then your only consumer rights is caveat emptor, let the buyer beware. But if it's from a trader, and that could even be someone who part-time buys and sells goods to make money, then you have the full Sales of Goods Act, sad fart rights. So that's how it works. Thank you. Gentlemen, then.
I'm looking to change energy provider again. Is there any way of finding out the standing charge and kilowatt rate hours that they charge rather than relying on a comparison type to tell me which is the best good for them?
You can always find their rates, but they make it very difficult. If you go via Cheap Energy Club, which is our comparison system that then keeps you up to date, we publish their rates before you go forward. So you can click a link and it will show you the standing charge. It'll show you the standing charge and it will show you the unit cost charge as well. So that's probably the easiest way to do it. And also, we try and make the answer correct as well. But of course, if you have variable usage and you want to look at it yourself, or perhaps you want a no standing charge tariff, and there's a guide to my site that lists the five available, that's five, isn't it, not that? The five available no standing charge tariffs, then you can do that. But yeah, they do not make it that transparent. Actually, standing charge and unit rates, I have a big thing. We should change the name. We should call it meter rental, not standing charge. You all get a phone, don't you? You have your line rental and then you pay for your calls. But standing charge and kilowatt hour usage is very confusing for people. So I would actually say that you put that, but the UN also call it meter rental, like line rental, because you all get that, and then you call it kettle cost. So we come up with a new unit, which is a unit for the cost of boiling a kettle. And we say you effectively used 422 boiled kettles, and we charge you 7.2p per boiled kettle. And I think that might make it a little bit easier for people to conceptually understand how it works. Anyway, I've suggested that one to government as well, but there we go. Just take that lady there, because she's got her hand up loud and large, and then I'll stop, and I'm running over into somebody else's time.
I'm throwing this at you, all right?
It was a lady with the, what do they call them?
A gilet. And how useful, how worth it is it to have content insurance if you pay for all your most valuable items using a credit card?
Absolutely useful. Credit card doesn't cover you for theft. It doesn't cover you for damage. It only covers you if you bought something that was faulty. Right? Faulty goods. If you drop a hammer on a television set, it wasn't faulty that it broke. If someone comes in and nicks your TV set, it wasn't faulty that it broke. If the ceiling of the person, if your ceiling falls in onto your TV set, it wasn't faulty. So they're just not, they don't equate at all. One very quick tip on contents insurance. This is enough, and I can tell from your question that you may do this. Right? When you walk around your house and add up how much you've got more than you think you have. I guarantee whatever you think your stuff is worth, it's worth more once you include your clothes and things like that. So you walk around your house, you say, I've got 20 grand's worth of stuff when I add up everything in my house. And then you say, how much should I cover? I'm never going to claim 20 grand. I'm just going to insure 10 grand because it's cheaper to insure 10 grand's worth of stuff, right? This is what likely happens. The claim assessor comes, goes, $20,000 worth of stuff here. You've only insured 10 grand. It's always the same fella, isn't it? Your television. He was the one who was in the store earlier, do you remember? Your television is broken. It's a grand television, but you've only covered off your stuff. So I'm going to give you 50% of its value, not 100% of its value. You're only going to get 500 quid because you've only paid for half the cover. You have to cover the actual amount you've got, not how much you will claim. And that seems to be a rather good way to end. I will now, and I dread how it's going to work with the next people, I'll be standing over there if any of you, for some bonkers reason, want a picture with me or something like that. I am happy to put on a false smile, because I'm never good at smiling. I'm much better at telling. I much prefer enduring talking. And chat to you very briefly, but it's going to have to be quick. So think what you're going to say in about 30 seconds while we're having the picture. You're going to have to talk about this speed and be standing over there just now. I do thank you very much for listening. It was very kind of you to come. Thank you.